Firstly, good afternoon, everybody. I hope you're keeping well. And thank you to ASB for inviting me and having me for this session today. And thank you to our audience out there for connecting to listen to the three of us. It is interesting times, and certainly the question of balancing between employees' productivity and their well-being comes into play. Where does the fulcrum sit to ensure that there is a balance? At PMB, we're working on four key levers. The first is communication. It is absolutely imperative that we have constant, clear, and very concise communications at all levels. And for us here at PMB, we have such an unprecedented level of communication all the way from our president and group chief executive officer to his leadership team, to the other people managers, and amongst the total workforce themselves. And I think this is very, very key to maintain that connectivity in the absence of social gatherings. But it also comes back to what is the platform that is enabling our staff to work and continue to delivering at that level of efficiency. So then it touches about we have to be technology driven, whether we like it or not, you know. And we're quite lucky that even prior to the MCO, there was already the IT tools were being put in place to enable us to work from home. I will grant you, the first 2 or 3 weeks I was told was quite challenging because not all our data and information have been digitized or in a central location. But you know what? Crisis builds efficiency and creativity, and my understanding is there is a certain flow in terms of the ways, changed ways of working that has worked for us. We do ensure that there is administrative IT support at all times because, you know, just when you want it, that webcam dies, you're not connected, and everything conspires against you. So you don't want our staff to be frustrated as they continue to deliver. The other thing is some part of our population has not been introduced to these tools. We cannot just expect them to just swim or drown. So there are modules that they can access offsite as we take them on this learning journey. And I think that's key. What has also helped us, we were going towards paperless meetings, you know. Okay, guys, let's ensure that's in the SharePoint. It doesn't need to be sophisticated. It has to be accessible. And that's key to give the enabler. But also when you talk about productivity is to ensure that the goals remain clear and that there are milestone goals that people can ensure that when managers or when the senior management can do their check-in, that there's something that they're working towards. And this is very important. Additionally, your deliverables sometimes get reprioritized. New priorities come up. What was a deliverable yesterday has morphed into something else and its importance. So that calls for a lot of adaptability. So there must be clarity of goals and as well as the milestones. And then that's how we drive efficiency. And the dashboard remains that's available. The fourth angle that I wanted to speak about was actually it goes back to communication, but is the other loop, is the feedback loop. Our staff need to be able to feedback or engage back with their leaders, project leaders, or colleagues, because they will need some guidance to continue doing what they're doing. They will also need to provide maybe some issues and challenges. And what I also find during these times is people come up with ideas because they're new challenges that has never been there before. So how does management, how do colleagues incorporate this? So I think those four levers are very key. When you position it against productivity, clear goals and deliverables, a communication that has a feedback loop, and an enabler of a technology so that our people continue to feel empowered. And you know what? Another thing is that there is a fair amount of challenge to ensure that some of the process bureaucracy is also relooked. And I'm not saying throw away the prudence of assessing risk or the governance, but you know, the process can be improved. And I think those are things when you talk about how do we grow, I think we can grow as processes becomes far more fluid. And that is our new ways of working in terms of how we retain employees' productivity during this crisis.
Thank you very much, Norlida, for the four great points. Sabri, would you like to say anything to that?
Yes, before I go into my own ideas about what the question will be about, I'm going to add one small thing to Norlida's responses now. Technology is good. It enables us to get things that we cannot do normally under these new circumstances. But I think one other quality that we must have is empathy, because technology can be rather overwhelming. Technology is not necessarily the leadership of the organization, should be a bit more empathetic to understand that not everybody in the organization are comfortable using new technology to reach out and get the work done. Having said that, I think the most important thing we've got to do right now to ensure that people are performing and motivated at the highest level as usual is for us to be open and honest with our people. And I'm sure a lot of people out there are going to go, open and honest. But of course, what I'm saying is that it's not natural for people to be open and honest. Let me tell you what happened to me some years ago in my previous life. I had the great misfortune of being in a situation where the company helicopter went down offshore Sabah, and 11 people passed away in that particular tragedy. And we were running around as part of the crisis management team, trying to manage inquiries from everybody, including the press. And after about half an hour or so, one of my staff, actually, who used to be my client, became my staff very quickly. He came into the room and he says, "Boss, excuse me, you guys are talking about something which is really, really important to the organization. You know, and somehow you're not sharing with us what's wrong with the organization. We're picking up things from the press. Newspapers are calling in." So at that point in time, we realized we have forgotten to connect to those people who are most important to us, the employees themselves. So reaching out to people, being open and honest about things, is not natural. It's not automatic. So we need to touch base with everyone in our team and ask them what's going on. Because right now I'm still coaching 3 or 4 people, despite this lockdown situation we're in right now. And I've asked all 3 of them, have you had really meaningful conversation with your bosses to ask you guys how you are doing at this point in time? And all 3 of them, the answer is a disappointing no. So, you know, it amplifies the point that while we are caught up with things and we mean well, all of us do, but somehow to be honest, truthful, and reaching out to people to be seen to be honest and truthful and to be caring in that process as well is not automatic to most of us. So that's what I would like to encourage leaders to consider to do a bit more of at this point in time of our lives. Michelle?
Yes, thank you very much, Sabri. If you don't mind switching on your video as well, that would be wonderful. So thank you very much, both. You know, empathy is so very, very important. And I would just like to add a little bit around that. And I think that at a time like this, when we're feeling so overwhelmed, when we're so filled with anxiety, with this uncertainty that's going on in the world, sometimes too much empathy can also be destructive and dangerous. And so, you know, being a psychotherapist myself, I'd like to just maybe explain a little bit about the different types of empathy. So there's empathy on a neural level, so on a cognitive level where you understand what is going on in the situation. There's empathy where you put yourself in the other person's shoes. And then there's something called compassion. And compassion is the ability to understand and feel it, but not to be overwhelmed by it. So I think it's really, really critical as well when we're looking at connecting with our people, when we're looking at the emotional responses we have to people, to feel that compassion, to want to help them, but not to be overwhelmed with empathy to the point where we paralyze ourselves. So it's still very important for the leader to remain calm. So that's just my 2 cents worth on that point. Going on to the next question. What are some of the most important factors or values you feel organizations can uphold when trying to balance productivity and employee well-being during times like this? So, Norlida, I understand that PNB's values include competence, humility, integrity, prudence, and passion. Would you say that these values continue to remain relevant at a time like this? And if not, what other values would you say should come out more prominently?
that plays to the strength of where we are when we talk about, you know, when we talk about just now, when we're reaching people, when they're working from home, because our people have such a strong pride of association that I think somehow they will feel very connected. And I think this comes back to how I would like to answer these questions, in that the values remains very important to us, but there are two streams I think that comes about. One is trust. And I'd like to talk trust within the context of trust, integrity, and accountability. Do you know, when we talked about empathetic leadership, it's like, you know, do as much as we think, do the leaders trust the people? We also need to understand is, will the people trust the leaders, that the leaders are going to help them navigate these uncharted waters, you know? And that's why I throw in credibility. And credibility is measured by the actions that the leader has shown in other circumstances of, like you said, compassion, Michelle. You know, you can be very sympathetic, but when you're compassionate and you retain that calmness to help to think about the employees, but still chart the organization, to me, that's a leadership balance that cannot be denied. So that goes to me, you know, in terms of trust and credibility on both parties. But I also think there's another element that's very important, which is accountability. At the end of it, it comes to every individual today in the organization. We are part of an organization that was hired to do something. Do we still feel that it is our responsibility to connect with the organization, with our colleague and our leaders, to ensure that how do we get these things done? Rather than, oh, I can't do this, you didn't give me enough tools. So I think this times calls for a two-way relationship. So for me, that's the trust, integrity, and accountability. And the other one I think that's coming up really, really strongly falls under the agility. When you talk about agility, is working from home is really asking us to adopt agility beyond anybody's notion of what could be possible. But the other key thing is adaptability. You know, it's like new things are coming up. Priorities get changed. New solutions may come out. So are we going to wait until the MCO is over? I don't think we can afford to. So I think this is where we talk about, you know, re-evaluating where are the bureaucracies? Where is the solutioning coming from? So, you know, people talk about the agile organizations. My God, are we not living in terms of agile? And I think when you have agile leadership, agile structure, then trust comes about, right? I can't see you, but you are delivering. So I think those two factors, and with the chip, with the DNA that you talked about, PNB values, these are the factors that come to play. And I like what Sabri had speaked about, because somewhere along the line, the four levers that we are defining our ways of working must be underlined by authentic leadership and very engaged workforce. And I think then the productivity comes as a natural output.
Thank you very much, Norlida. I think I would also like to add to that, you know, I think we had a little conversation before this as well, you know, about how culture and organizations' culture is amplified when in a situation of crisis. And if you do not have the right values and the right culture in place, you will see during a crisis situation that things can fall apart. Sabri, would you like to add something to this about, you know, self-motivation and self-directed leadership?
Thank you, Michelle. About a year and a half ago, I finished a short survey study. I will not call it research, for a client, because they were interested in what motivates the people to perform. And what I did was we crafted some questions, and it was built around the issue of culture, organizational values, team leadership, the support they get from the team, compensation systems, and internal motivation. I think about, if I remember correctly, about 85% of respondents told us that it does not matter everything else. What really drives me to perform at the highest level is what goes on inside of me. Because a lot of us seem to think that, you know, if you want good performance, you pay, you reward these guys, and they will perform for you. And if you perform well, you get rewarded in turn. But there are organizations which are not quite like that. You know, the performers and the non-performing people, there's not so much difference between how you reward a performer and what a non-performer really gets. There is a slight difference, but not much. There are organizations which are like that. I shall not mention what organizations they are, but I think you have an idea. So we talked to some of these people, the high performers in those organizations, and the answer is the same, that these are performing people, and we get crappy bosses, some of them do, and yet it does not matter. And some of them don't get very much difference in terms of compensation at the end of the year, and yet they remain high-performing people year after year after year. And I talked to them, every one of them, a couple of hundred people at the end of the process, and they kept telling me that it does not matter what kind of a boss I have, how little or how much I get in terms of my bonus and rewards, because sometimes we don't get bonuses in our organizations, but still, I'm driven to perform. So I asked them, so what drives you forward? What is this, the secret to your energy? The answer is the intrinsic values that I have within me. So the question now is, so what can leaders do right now in this situation that we are in right now to work on that? My answer to that question would be to reach out, like the old AT&T commercial in the 80s in the US would say, just reach out and touch someone. At this point in time, it's very important that leaders just pick up the phone and talk to our people, not about work, if I may, but talk about themselves, talk about their values, talk about their families, and ask them how they are doing right now. And yes, you don't have to do this with everybody in your organization. You cannot do that. It's not practical. But here, the 80-20 rule applies. Focus on those 20% of the people who are performing like crazy in your organization, who are carrying 80% of that load. Talk to them, focus on their well-being and their happiness. And I promise you this, if they are happy and they feel good about it, they will perform for you no matter what. That is my point.
Thank you, Sabri. Yeah, so I think I'd just like to add something to that as well. And I'm not taking it from the point of view of a leader. I'm taking it more from the point of view of an employee. And I'd just like to reach out to anyone who's listening, who's an employee out there, who feels like, you know, they're not in a good place now, they're down, like, you know, they can't get in the office, they no longer know what they're doing, they can't find value in your work. I think it's also important for them to dig really, really deep and to find the kind of self-leadership that comes from within. If you haven't thought about the meaning of the work that you do, if you haven't thought about your purpose and why you're doing the work you're doing, now is a really good time to actually self-examine and to try and figure that out. Because as much as anyone else tries to motivate you, your boss, your manager, you know, your colleagues, it all comes down to you right now. When there's no one looking over your shoulder, when there's no one monitoring you, when there's no one micromanaging you, what are you going to do? Yep. So yeah, that's just my thoughts. So going on to the next question, the final one, before we open it for the audience, question 3, do you see these changes influencing the future of work? And if so, how? Norlida, we'll start with you again.
Sure. You know, it's very interesting when you use the word of future of work. Actually, for me, the future of work is now. I mean, I think the pandemic, and unfortunate as it is, and that we have to work from home, this is the greatest pilot of anything. You know, everybody thought and talked about working from home as a theory. Everybody now is experiencing it. So for me, the future work of one thing, and I think it differs from organization to organization. There have been startups that have been working from home and wondering what the fuss is about. You know, it's very different to different organizations. But from, I think, the organizations, it is already going to, it's accelerating some of the works that we're doing. I think I talked to you about how we were already doing the digitization and digitalization. And there is a certain way of doing new things. For example, I've joined PMB only for a week. I had a digital onboarding, and coming up the ramp has all been by digital connections. That is a new way of work. I'm not sure that it has hampered my understanding any less. So I think the future of work is really now. So how is it going to impact? It's going to impact policies in terms of flexible working arrangements beyond just working from home. You talked about purpose just now. In a very multi-generational workforce as we have today, the definition of identifying a purpose of what an organization stands for, it's already been called to test for us today, right? So it's going to impact this. So one of the things that is also in my portfolio is culture transformation. And it's just like, it's now, it's happening by our flexible working arrangements. Another one which is coming up from the digital journey is also the knowledge management that we are building within PNB, institutionalizing information, data, that's all going to be accelerated. But I also think one of the things that's also going to change is we talked about maybe from a little bit, it may sound HR-ish, but when we talk about the EVP of an organization, what is the value proposition? It really, I think no other time has that work-life integration been so challenged as it is today. And to Sabri's point is, when we use these levers that already elicit the motivation, then performance is going to come up. What is also interesting, though, is when we work remote is, and we talk about building an empowered and collaborative environment, and we have to check in. We need to be very cautious. We can't check in every 5 minutes because the poor guy is going to feel that, oh, this is my back to micromanaging worlds. So there is the pros and cons that we need to balance. And I think balance is really the right title for this, because when you're working from home, you're really practicing empowerment, but yet you want to keep the connectivity. So therefore you should call and ask how they are first, not how is my project going. I do agree with that. So I think those are, when I talk about how is it going to influence, it's definitely going to influence the way we do work in more ways than just one ways of working, the governance around how we implement things, and just the entire value system in an organization.
Thank you, Norlida. I agree with you. I think, you know, these kind of situations teach us how to be human. You know, it'll bring back that human element into our work life, you know, that integration. So, you know, a lot of times they say, just leave your emotions at the door, you know. Don't bring your emotions to work. Don't be emotional when you come to the office. But, you know, when times are difficult like this, it's the leader who can channel, who can find that that ability to connect with others, that's the most crucial. So bringing a human side back to it, I think, is really critical. Sabri, what are your thoughts on this?
Michelle, I used to think, I grew up with a father who went to war in the Second World War. He picked up a gun. He was a teacher, but he volunteered to defend the country against the Japanese onslaught at that point in time. And growing up with him, I always thought that we are a very fortunate generation, those that come after me, because we don't have to go through world wars. You know, but I don't think so anymore, because in our lifetime, we have had to deal with 9/11. And after 9/11, the world as we used to know then no longer exists. And after 9/11, we managed to change ourselves a lot. And we managed things well enough. And then we thought we were going okay. And then this COVID thingy hits us again. So the point is, the world is changing faster than we could possibly imagine. And the only thing that we need to have to be successful or work now and work into the future is the ability to adjust ourselves accordingly. The skills to learn new things. Those are things that are most needed right now. And if anything, we have stopped taking things for granted anymore. I mean, I used to think I'm going to go to work 9 to 5 and retire at the age or whatever, and that's good. But now I'm seeing that going to work, driving to the office, going through the morning traffic jam on even on Monday is something which I truly badly miss doing right now. I never thought I'd say that. And going to the office and having to sit in the same boardroom, meeting rooms, which I used to call the hell room for some reasons, I actually miss doing that. So even Sabri now has stopped taking things for granted. If anything, going into the future, the individual, as you say, Michelle, the humanity, the person behind the name, behind the employee registration number, matters more than before. And taking Norlida's point further, the EVP, you know, it's not just very HR-ish, it's a very important concept for us to not forget. The EVP of an organization is very important, very critical to know what is originally mandated for us to do, because that guides our decision-making into the future. But the EVP of a person, to me, is going to be even more important, because you got to wake up every morning and be aware, be mindful. What is it that I'm trying to do in my life right now, going to the future? Knowing very much, knowing very well that this life we're enjoying right now ain't going to be for long, because something else is going to come and disrupt life as usual into something different into the future. So if anything, do not take things for granted, and we are going to be even more concerned with the humanity of each other going into the future. Michelle.
Thank you very much, Sabri. I would give a word to what you just said. And when you said it, you know, things, you know, you thought you would work, retire at 53, and then, you know, spend a lot of years enjoying your life, you know, probably, I don't know, riding your big bikes, etc. but, you know, these things, you know, the things we expect to happen, the holidays we had planned, the children we have and the futures we see for them growing up, the careers we've defined for ourselves, all these are thrown into the wind during times of uncertainty. And a lot of what we're feeling right now is what we call anticipatory grief, meaning we anticipating the death of our dreams in a certain way. And so that's why it's really, really critical, like you say, to then find your own EVP within yourself. And also to that extent, I think to also learn to be able to let go of things. So Norlida's point about being adaptable, adaptability, it's not just organization, you know, wide. It's also as a human being, you know, the ability for us to be adaptable, the ability for us to, I think, be willing to let go of control to a certain extent. And this letting go of control will also help us, will permeate into our work in the sense that we then don't need to micromanage as such. We then don't need to, you know, like you say, just ask them first, how's the work going, instead of how are you, in the beginning of a conversation with our staff. So if we can let go of a certain amount of control, in the way that we want things to happen, I think it will open us up to a lot more adaptability in our lives. So thank you very much. I will summarize some of your questions right after this. But first of all, let's go and see some of the questions that the audience has brought up for us. There are a few good ones here, and my co-host, Dr. Tan, has been picking them for me. One of the ones I think that have come up here and which is also being talked about in the chat is on employee exits. So employee exits will become a norm. And in such an environment as this, how do you keep employees motivated and in the long run ready to accept the situation should this happen to them or to their colleagues? Would you like to start, Norlida, Sabri?
I guess the exits they are referring to is if it's voluntary or involuntary. And I can only speak right now from at least from our organization perspective. We are finding that jobs are being recrafted. So I don't want to say that these are excess people, because you are going to find that people's jobs are going to be redefined. What we are targeting to do is, as we get these efficiencies, are there new roles that can be crafted for our organization? Whether we are growing or not, there still needs to do some new tasks before we reach that optimal level of sizing. So one of the things that we are finding out is the new skills that the people have to learn. And it's quite interesting when we just talk about communication skills, right? We're now going by work from home. So there's whether video or audio. How strong are our communication skills? So that's killing up, right? But there are some jobs that may say, do we really need these jobs as it becomes digitized and digitalized along the journey? What we are hoping to be is that we are able to redeploy them. But I think exits are going to be very painful. And I know some organizations have already been talking about this. And I think those are the involuntary exits that you're talking about. But there is some protection during this period. And I think organizations, it behooves on them to see how can you help upskill them to the jobs that are likely to emanate after this. This was already happening as we were adopting digital sort of works that are coming, but this is just accelerating it, Michelle. I'm not sure whether that's specific enough, but that's what I feel about the exits that will be forthcoming. because every organization is going to really realize what is their optimal resourcing requirements against current deliverables. We don't know what the different deliverables are going to be.
Yes, exactly. And I think it's not just to do with your employees as well. It's to do with even how much floor space do you really need. If you know, working from home becomes a lot more normal in the new normal, then do you even need to rent as much floor space? You know, so it's
absolutely. I mean, you know, we are undertaking spatial work right now because Merdeka 118. So what kind of structures do we do right now? You know, what's the manpower capacity you do? Is it a 1-for-1 or 1-for-70? You know, very interesting questions. And I think this would fall under the third point you take. How is it going to impact the future of work?
And Sabri, have you ever had to experience having to let go of someone? And if so, how can a leader sort of start to bring himself into readiness to do such a thing?
Well, in my previous couple of lives, I was in HR for a while, quite some time actually. Right now, I think the exit that they're going to be seeing is going to be even more so than before. But what this COVID thing is going to be doing is to amplify everything, the quality, goodness of life, the evil, the issues that we have to face is going to be amplified by many, many folds. So I think right now, one good thing that leaders can do for themselves, the organizations, and for the people who are about to leave the organization would be to do this. In the exit interview, ask 4 questions. Number 1, what is it that you're really passionate about in your life? What might that be? Number 2, are you really good at doing it? Number 3, do you think people will want you to do that stuff? And number 4, do you think you're going to get paid by doing it? Those 4 things. The Japanese call it the ikigai, by the way. So if you could help have a conversation with us and with themselves, because granted, I've had this conversation with a lot of people I'm coaching right now. You cannot derive at the answer in one sitting, in one conversation. You have to have a series of very powerful, deep, thought-provoking conversations before you get to the answer to those questions. Because a lot of the time, we just do what we do because that's what the boss asks us to do. That's what the job description asks us to do. So we do what we can. But if you can find that one thing that this person is really excited about in his book, why he is created by God to do kind of thing, that one thing, once he finds out that what the one thing is, nothing else matters. And come hell or high water, COVID-19, 20 or 21, it's not going to stop him. You're going to find wonderful ways and means, get really creative, really innovative to do that he's really passionate about and get paid while doing it. And you know what? Chances are what he loves doing is what the world is going to need to be done in the future going forward.
Absolutely. I think a lot of high value jobs will appear. I mean, of course, a lot of, low-value jobs will still be maintained, you know, the workers who are doing all the necessary work at the moment. But at the same time, a lot of it can be taken over by computers, by AI, by digitalization. So it's really about finding what brings meaning to you in terms of the work you do. Another question that we have here, which comes from Claire, is... what are some initiatives your respective organizations are doing to help the re-entering of employees post-COVID-19? I think this is also critical because once the MCO is lifted or once, you know, whichever country you're sitting in, restricted movement orders are lifted, you'll find that we can't all flock back to the office at the same time. So you still need to have a staggered way of maintaining work from home and also staggering it as you start to move your people back into your offices. So what, Norlida, in your organization, do you have a plan going forward for this? Because in ASB at the moment, we sort of have a policy put in place already by our COO whereby we will do it bit by bit to ensure that even if there is a chance of someone falling ill from COVID or something, not the entire organization will then have to be, quarantined, for example. So what about in your situation?
We are also doing a phased-in re-entry. The reality of it, even if the MCO is lifted, there are some measures I think we should still retain. I mean, I know this is perhaps when we talk about social distancing. So how many people are we going to bring back? Leadership, do we bring all the leadership? What happens if it recurs? So there's going to be a split of critical roles of leadership and location. And also as we try and now make working from home, which we hope to make it a way of working, or is it a way of life, depending how you look at it, you know, then do we really need to bring 100%? Are there roles that we can already begin the adoption of working from home? So we are working on that plan on the re-entry. We want to strengthen our technology platform so we can ensure that this happens almost seamless, like maybe 20% continue to work on a rotation basis. So you do get the benefit. The benefit of working from home is people don't have to go to the traffic jam. I know Sabri loves the jam right now, but some people can do without it. But you know, the interesting thing is that we think about working from home, and I think we chatted before, the change to our household cannot be undermined. We used to spend maybe only 6 waking hours at home. Now we're spending 24 hours, you know? So there is like some people telling me, Puan, when it's lifted, I want to be the first one back. I'm like saying, no, you can't, you know? But those are some of those challenges. We are making arrangements. Those are the initiatives. Who comes back when? And then what is the new ways of working?
Wonderful. There's another question here. Or thought really shared by Cheryl, and she says that she's seen this been happening in India and in the US. Leaders who are really getting a huge salary can take a pay cut and provide those less fortunate in keeping your job so they can provide for their family. It needs a great deal of sacrifice, but this is what humanity is about. And I suppose it's about putting your money where your mouth is. So if are we looking at a situation whereby maybe big CEO salaries will be cut down going forward, whether, it's time for us to reevaluate the way we calculate wages, the way we pay them? Is this something organizations should even think about? Norlida or Sabri?
You know, I think remuneration policies in Malaysia are being reviewed. I mean, you know what the... there is said that somewhere along the line, there is wage suppression in Malaysia, right? I mean, people who work overseas and we try and bring them back to Malaysia, you already know the issues that we have, right? So I think the wage recalibration is going to happen across. Should we be giving up our salary for the good cause? I think so many of us, I know, are already donating to the various charities that they stand for the community causes. So I don't know whether there is any plans for this, but I think there are already avenues where personal earnings are going to the good causes, from my understanding.
Sabri, any thoughts?
I think quite a number of our leaders are already doing that. Michelle, I think the Prime Minister, the entire cabinet has already announced that they are giving up half of their salary or something like that. And also the King himself has done that.
Yes.
I think it's a step in the right direction for us to be doing that. But the question is the quantum of reduction. How many percent are we going to be doing that? Is it going to be a uniform percentile applied to everybody across the levels? Or is it going to be staggered as we go higher? Is it going to be given up more of the salary or less of a salary as we go down the levels? I do not know. That's open for discussion. But the very basic level, I think we should all be considering be doing that already. But the bigger question would be, where is this reduction of money going to be diverted into or towards? I have no problems giving up a bit of my salary, but I am quite concerned. I want to see the money being sent to the group of people who are really in need of that money. That's all I want to say.
Thank you very much, Sabri. We've had a few questions coming in around the same topic, which is, does your organization monitor or track the productivity since the implementation of MCO? And have you actually seen a drop in efficiency? Norlida?
We do track, but you know, it's not as if we have a project manager that tracks all the thing, but because I mentioned a little bit earlier, we have defined what our goals are. So each person responsible is checking in to see that there is progress in the projects. And you know, projects varies between long dated deliverables and short term. So if you're able to delineate between them, then it's easier to do. We do track it. And fortunately, my understanding, talking to my colleagues at the leadership team as well, we are still on track and hope to do so. But you know, this is like at this stage, should there be challenges as we go ahead? I think that's only to be defined. But so far, not bad. I think so. I think the spirits are still high, commitment. And I think this is where most organizations are putting that engagement, putting that enablers, and having to stay a little bit afloat during these difficult times.
All right. Thank you very much, Norlida and Sabri. Any closing thoughts that you would like to leave our viewers with? We still have a few minutes left before we close this. And any thoughts that you think you'd like to say to maybe summarize what you think so far?
Okay.
Can I go first?
Yes, go first, Fabri.
Right. I don't have I'm not going to summarize. I think it's yours to do. I'm going to just a quick rundown on some tips I've been thinking about, because we talk about leaders and what they do right now in this COVID semi-lockdown position we're in right now. But what does an employee do working from home? How does a person work from home? Because to be honest, this is the first time for me too. So I've thought about things, and I've got some pointers I've listed down, about seven of them. I'm going to go down the list very quickly. Number one, for those who are new to this working from home thingy, you got to work on the mindset that you are working. Because the thing about being at home is that everything else in the system will tell you, if you're home, I ain't going to work. Say, I got to do some stuff which is more fun, ride my motorcycles, do whatever makes you happy, bake breads, whatever, you know, you're excited doing. So you got to work on the mindset that you are working. And you got to surround yourself with things that make you work. You got to wear clothes that tell your body, hey, I am working today. If you have to dress up, put a tie on, by all means, do that. What are your working hours? Make that clear. You got to work a 9-to-5, do it 9-to-5 thingy. And you know what? Observe it. Observe the breaks in between, the 15 minutes fresh air or the not so fresh air. You got to take a puff in. Do that. And give yourself a well-deserved lunch break. And if it's allowed, go out to have lunch, a short lunch if you can. If you cannot have lunch at home, do that. But have lunch. Stick to your normal working routine. If you get up in the morning, you got to brush your teeth, shave your beard, and have a cup of coffee, and then move into this working mode of thinking, do so. Maintain that routine. Maintain a dedicated office space, kind of, if you can do that. And number five is attend meetings, quote-unquote, online. Be seen and be heard, kind of. And if you have to be guilty of anything right now, as Charlie says, you be guilty of over-communicating with each other. Find time to socialize too. And finally, at the end of the day, at the end of a long working day, you got to do something to close shop. Whatever that closing shop process, the procedure or routine means to you, go through all that and put your laptop in your laptop bag if you have to, and then go home. That's how it should be, I think. And that maintains this thing about working from home thing in a more regularized and streamlined way for guys like me, especially. Michelle?
Thank you, Sabri. And I think also I'd like to add to that because you have the routine in place and you know what your working hours are, you're then allowed to rest after that. Sometimes when we mix it up too much, you know, even when we're not working, we forget to take our leisure times because we're working from home and we think that, oh, we can work continuously and there's no end to it. So it's also very key when the minute you put your computer in your computer bag, you're actually switching off and you're allowing your brain to relax. You're allowing yourself to take that breath and say, okay, it's the end of the day, I can rest now. And rest is so, so very critical when, in time when we're so very anxious about everything. Any closing thoughts, Norlida?
I love your tips. I really believe we should set boundaries because otherwise we lose this work-life integration. And for me, I was thinking, you know, this MCO has really given us a pause for reflection of who we are. And I, as corny as it may sound, I want to say that I hope we bring our better selves to our professional organizations and in our personal lives. I think that's very important because we've had such an opportunity to make a difference in so many ways. We should maximize this this opportunity, no matter how awful the circumstances may be.
Wonderful. Yes. I think being able to be grateful every day, practicing gratitude every day is really, really critical. Okay, so just let me summarize a little bit about what we've said. So in terms of question one, we'll go back over there. Question one, how can organizations continue to maintain, if not grow, the employees' productivity during times of crisis? Dr. Tan has helped me to summarize this while I've been trying to moderate everything. And Norlida, clear communication, ramp up employees' support, clear goals with milestones to allow for agility and fluid processes are the four key things. Sabri, being empathetic, being open and honest. It's not natural. You must make the effort, reach out to people. And I think it's about the feedback loop that you mentioned as well. Question number two, a quick summary. What are some of the most important factors, values organizations can uphold when trying to balance productivity and employee well-being? Norlida, trust, integrity, to have a common purpose and connection are the key values. Why do we do what we do? Agility is more important than ever. And Sabri, being empathetic again. Question why you do what you do. And number three, will these changes influence the future of work? And if so, how? Norlida, future of work is now. This is a great pilot, yes, for us to prepare ourselves. Avoid micromanaging. Can check in every 5 minutes. Ask how they are first before asking about work. And Sabri, learn new things. Reskill. Don't take things for granted. This is the time to test our resiliency. So thank you very much, both of you. And thank you very much to our audience for joining us today. We look forward to seeing you the next time. Stay tuned as we'll be holding more webinar series around the day after tomorrow. We will email you and keep you updated. Please use the survey link in the chat box or the QR code. Code to suggest any topics of interest you might have or to provide us with any feedback. And have a great week, everybody. Stay safe, stay at home, no walking your dogs or going jogging. Keep healthy, and we'll see you again soon. Thank you very much. Bye.
Thank you. Thank you, Michelle. Thank you, everybody. Keep safe.
Bye. Keep safe.